اللهم على سيدنا رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه. أما بعد, we will take a break from our usual tazkiyah text that I teach, in other words, my text, to come to a better text. Though we won't be, I won't be able to spend a lot of time on everyone, and it's worth spending the time on, but for the sake of completion, we will try to sort of go through an abbreviated discussion of the aphorisms of Ibn Ata'illah or Al-Hikam Al-Ata'iyyah by Al-Imam Ibn Ata'illah Sakandari rahimahullah ta'ala wa radiya anhu wa nafa'ana bi'ulumihi. The first, he says, obviously, so we just have a quick understanding of who is Ibn Ata'illah. Ibn Ata'illah Sakandari from Alexandria, Egypt. He is the direct student of Abu al-Abbas, or Al-Mursi Abu al-Abbas, rahimahullah ta'ala. And Al-Mursi Abu al-Abbas is a direct student of Abu al-Hasan al-Shadhili. Ibn Ata'illah, rahimahullah, is said to be, on one occasion, a Maliki faqih, on another occasion, a Shafi'i faqih. And his aphorisms, are really famous in a sense that no text of tazkiyah, suluk, or tasawwuf but refers to them. And you know, we can sit here and praise it a lot because it is really praiseworthy. Lakin, that's not the point. Let's take a few things from it and then we'll go on inshallah ta'ala. The first hikmah or aphorism that he says, قال الإمام أحمد بن عطاء الله السكندري رحمه الله تعالى نقصان الرجاء من علامة الاعتماد على العمل عند وجود الزلل. No, هذا actually من علامة الاعتماد على العمل نقصان الرجاء عند وجود الزلل. The print is wrong. هذه أفضل؟ والله يا مولانا لو أفضل أحسن. شكرا. أيوه خلاص. فهذه Arabic is أيوه من علامة الاعتماد على العمل نقصان الرجاء عند وجود الزلل. Though this would make it understanding and understandable in a sense. نقصان الرجاء من علامة الاعتماد على العمل عند وجود الزلل. Okay, nice. Whoever wrote this sort of changed the way, the sequence of the wording. خير. Always nice to keep things the way the scholars themselves have written them. There is barakah in what the scholars have written because these writings come from the hal, which is of ilm and of knowledge and of spirituality and of. And I know sometimes we think we can click in one dimension of the writing of some scholars like that, but the best is always to keep things original and then move around them. He says, من علامة الاعتماد على العمل, among or a sign of depending on one's deeds is the lack of hope when you slip into error. A sign of depending on your deeds is that you lose hope when you make a mistake, is what he's saying. So when someone makes a mistake, a deep mistake, they sort of lose hope. They feel as if they are, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala totally severed their connection with Him. And Ibn Ata'illah is saying, this is the reason for that is because you depend on your amal. And that's the problem. What's the problem? Who do you rely on? Do you rely on Allah or you rely on your deeds? If you rely on your deeds, then you think Allah should treat you based on your deeds. And since your deeds are not worthy, you wouldn't treat someone with unworthy deeds in a worthy way. So then you compare Allah wal-ayyadhu billah to yourself, and that's the problem. That's a bigger problem. But the other problem is that you rely on your deeds in being close to Him versus Allah Ta'ala ordered you to perfect your deeds and rely on Him.
You perfect your amal, but you rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why do you perfect your amal? Because Allah asked you to perfect it. Is the amal the reason that you get the rahmah of Allah? Hadith Muslim. لَنْ يُدْخِلَ أَحَدُكُمْ عَمَلَهُ الْجَنَّةِ None of you's amal will make you enter Jannah. قَالُوا وَلَا أَنْتَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ How about you, O Prophet of Allah? This is not even me. إِلَّا أَنَّ اللَّهَ تَغَمَدَنِي بِرَحْمَتِهِ Except that Allah has already granted me His mercy. How do you get then close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Based on your good thinking of Him and relying on Him, yes, you need to perfect your deeds. He's not telling you that you should then ignore your deed totally. No, no, no. It's not ignoring the deed. It's perfecting the deed but not relying on the creation, which is your deed. But rely on the Creator subhanahu wa ta'ala. For if you don't perfect your deed, you're disobeying Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to obey Him, or asked you, let me be more technical, asked you to obey Him, but also asked you to rely on Him. Perfect your deed to obey Him. Don't ever rely on anything but Allah. If you make a mistake and you rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that mistake may be mendable. Like I said earlier in the khutbah today. But if you don't rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you are alone with your deed. And your deeds are not going to take you far. So that's what he's saying. The first symptom is that if you have this feeling that you lose hope when you commit a grave sin, it means you're relying on your deed. You have to change your thinking to realize what you did is absolutely wrong and grave, but you need to rely on Allah's generosity. You need to rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's forgiveness. You need to rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy and love, and that's the way that gets you there anyway. For a Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us in the authentic hadith, حُسْنُ الظَّنِّ مِنَ الْعِبَادَةِ Right? The good thinking about Allah is ibadah. And if you think bad about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then there's a problem. The problem of people nowadays in general is that they always depend on their deeds. And the problem is not only that, they measure the outer surface or the outer layer of their deeds, and they compare themselves to other people based on what they see of other people's deeds. But He ordered you to do the deed and ordered you not to look at your deed. But expect the mercy from Him. He doesn't reward you on your deed based on how good your deed is. That's not the scale. He rewards you on your deed based on His own generosity subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why He didn't set limits for the multitudes. يُضَاعِفُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ He multiplies to whomever He wants. He just didn't say how many multiplications, but multiplies. For the deed itself, again, is a far' an asl. Far' means a branch from a foundation. All right. The next one, he says, إرادتك التجريد. مع إقامة الله إياك في الأسباب من الشهوة الخفية وإرادتك الأسباب مع إقامة الله تعالى إياك في التجريد انحطاط عن الهمة العلية. All right. This means your desire to dispossess when the Lord has set you up with means is a concealed lust. And your desire to possess the means, when your Lord has set you up in disposition, is a decline away from the high result that he expects of you.
Let me say it again.
Tajreed means, you know, you don't have anything. So detachment. Your desire to be detached or dispossessed of any dispossessions. When Allah has set you up with means, Allah put you in something. Now you don't want the thing, that you don't want your current situation that Allah has put you in, you want something else. So you try now to start to suggest to Allah as what is better for you. Where Ibn Atta is saying your desire to dispossess when Allah has set you up with the means is a concealed desire. You're still filled with that desire. You're not there. You want to do something. You want to do, you know, you want to be not where he puts you. Though he's asking you to maximize your potential in the position he puts you in right now. He's not asking you not to make dua to get to the highest situation. You can, and you should. But while that is happening, and you're making dua, you maximize the potential that you're in now. For your desire to dispossess what he has given you is a concealed lust. And your desire to possess the means when he has deprived you of them is declining the high resolve that is expected of you. What? أَمْ حَسِبْتُمْ أَن تَدْخُلُوا الْجَنَّةَ وَلَمَّا. You think you're going to enter Jannah and you have not been tested? I mean, you think, it's this, you know, students always argue about this. They think the first grade tests should be exactly like the second grade, and the second grade should be exactly like the first, and the third should be like the first, and the fourth should be like the first, and middle school should be also like first. Why is it getting difficult? Huh? What do you mean, why is it getting difficult? I mean, what, you always need to be in the first grade? Is that what you expect? That's not how it is. But it's always, among these desires is talking big and walking big, but not having big. Yeah, studied a couple of texts, now we want to talk like big people. We want to walk like big people. We want to act like big people. But how about internalization of that knowledge that made these people supposedly big, big? These are all internal desires. So he's saying that your desire to dispossess when the Lord has set you up with means. If Allah has set you up with means, use them. Use them for a good reason, for his sake, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Put them to use. Because if you say, he says that's a concealed desire. And your desire to possess the means when he has set you up in dispossession is a decline away from high resolve. And you need both in order for you to escalate the ladder of spirituality or closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You need a high motivation. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والذين جاهدوا فينا Allah says لنهدينهم سبلنا. Those who do jihad in us, they struggle so much, Allah called the jihad in our path, we shall guide them to our way. The meaning of the ayah. It's this difficult. So if you think it's just a walk in the park, it's not. And if you always want to have first grade tests for the rest of your life, this is how much you know. You know a first grade worth for the rest of your life, even if you're 60 years old. You remember the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when the first ayahs were revealed to him. Ya ayyuhal muzzammil, qum. Ya ayyuhal mudathir. Ya ayyuhal muzzammil, both. And in both ayahs, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders him to do things. Qum fa'anzir. Stand up and go and give the da'wah. Stand up and do the work, basically. Then he says in the third, سوابق الهمم لا تخرق أسوار الأقدار. Strong resolves do not pierce the walls of destiny. Now, how do we understand that? With understanding also that the person has a choice. That strong resolves do not pierce the walls of destiny. Well, you're not the only one that exists in this universe. And destiny and the qadar is really interlinked and interconnected and overlaps with many things. And sometimes, and the qadr of one person is not one person by themselves, there's always many other entities that are there. And therefore, that's why when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told Ibn Abbas in the authentic hadith, وَاعْلَمْ أَنَّمَا أَصَابَكْ, know that which hit you was never gonna miss you, and that which missed you was never meant to hit you. Yes, you do have your free choice, that free choice that's not sovereign though. Lakin, you have to realize that there is a bigger thing than you in this universe, and that the qadr subjugates everything and overlaps over everything, and sometimes things will happen that are beyond your control. So regardless how strong your resolve is, does not pierce the walls of destiny, but that strong resolve helps you stand and move along with the waves of the destiny and the qadr in a way that's number one empowering to you and pleasing to Allah Rabbul Alameen. Otherwise, people sit and mourn and complain about Allah to His creation, and that's not going to help anything, and nor will it change anything. Then he says in number four, أرح نفسك من التدبير فما قام به غيرك عنك لا تقم به لنفسك. He says, rest yourself from over planning. Whatever someone else has undertaken for you, don't attempt to do it yourself. What does that mean? What are we doing tomorrow? Are you supposed to plan? Yes. Do you have control of tomorrow? No. As long as you live, Allah will grant you your rizq. That's a secured, it's a secured thing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted rizq for everyone who's living. Good. Are you supposed to seek rizq? Yes. Allah tells Maryam, وَهُزِّي إِلَيْكِ بِجِذْعِ النَّخْلَةِ, shake the palm tree. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also asked you to worry about things, or not worry about things that He secured for you. Do what you want, but don't overwhelm yourself, and don't take the whole thing, the whole space of your intellectual, your most intellectual space, in trying to do something that's already there for you. All you have to do is not the planning, all you have to do is the seeking. And he explains it in the number one, fifth, in the fifth aphorism, where he says, اجتهادك فيما ضمن لك وتقصيرك فيما طلب منك دليل عن طماس البصيرة فيك أو منك. He says, your strive to acquire which he guaranteed for you, and your delinquency in performing that which he demanded of you, are signs of your lack of insight. Your strive to acquire what he guaranteed for you. You live, you're gonna eat, if you seek. And then your delinquency in performing what he demanded of you. So what do we do today? We make sure that we have, like I said, a loaf of bread on the table for the kids to eat. We don't care what kind of spiritual food the kids take. Doesn't matter. We care only about what kind of food that goes in the stomach. You strive to acquire what he guaranteed for you, and your delinquency in performing what he demanded of you are signs of your lack of vision or insight. انطماس البصيرة, بصيرة is the vision of the heart. The vision of the heart is not there. He guaranteed you happiness if you are with him. You try to seek happiness with people that actually disobey him. And you're delinquent about trying to seek happiness in things that have to do with him. Majalis that have to do with him. Places that have to do with him. People that remind you of him. You're not going to get happiness. And that's a sign that your basira is blind. Your heart is blind. The basira is really here, is the heart. It's not the vision that's blind, as the Quran mentions. But the heart is. Then he says in number 6, لا يكن تأخر أمد العطاء مع الإلحاح في الدعاء موجبا ليأسك فهو ضمن لك الإجابة فيما يختاره لك لا فيما تختاره لنفسك وفي الوقت الذي يريد لا في الوقت الذي تريد. Let not the delay of answering your prayers, despite your persistence in asking, be cause for despair and hopelessness. For he has guaranteed answering your prayers with what he wills for you, not what you choose for yourself, and in the time he pleases, not the time you want. So here's the thing, obviously, this number 6 talks about dua. And obviously, dua mukhul ibadah, dua is the heart of ibadah. And subhanAllah, the dua being the heart of ibadah, and most people leave dua. And when they do dua, it's ceremonial. I mean, imam is doing some dua, Ameen. Though Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is informing you in the authentic hadith, dua is the heart of ibadah. One other riwayah, dua huwa al-ibadah. Dua is the ibadah. We don't do dua. We don't learn the dua. We don't do dua. What do you mean learn dua? You have many ad'iyah the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned. The ad'iyah, the anbiya mentioned, Allah mentioned about the anbiya in the Quran. The dua that Allah Ta'ala mentioned that He likes in the Quran, for example. You ought to memorize them, they're not that plenty. Now, can you make your own dua with your own words? Absolutely. Sure, make whatever dua you like. But surely, it's always nice to use dua that you know is beloved to someone. So you make dua, and then you're saying, but you know what, I am so sinful, I'm not really, if I was to use it on myself, if I was to answer my call, I wouldn't answer my call. Where's the problem? You can't compare Allah to the creation. He doesn't treat you based on what you do. Again, He treats you based on His generosity, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Comparing Allah to the creation leads to blasphemy. You make dua and you say, most likely Allah will not answer me anyway. I'm not worthy of being answered. Not because of anything, but because of my sins. Don't speak on behalf of Allah. Allah did not give you His knowledge. Number 2, Allah is more generous than you can comprehend. And more giving and more forgiving than you can actually capacitate and start to understand. And all that results from your ignorance in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then. Hence, Ibn Ata'Allah says, let not the delay. So now you made dua sincerely and you have a yaqeen, faithfulness that he will answer you. But then he does, nothing happens, you wait. You made the dua very nicely with full yaqeen and sincerity and everything and all that. And you finished the dua and Jibreel did not come. You're looking around, no Jibreel. Next day also, nobody knocks on the door, says, here, I am Jibreel, I'd like to do things for you, you know, all these things. 1 month go by, 2 months go by, things don't happen. 1 year, 2 years. Ibn Ata says, rahimahullah, let not the delay of answering your prayers, despite your persistence. You didn't just make dua once, because those who make dua once have forgotten that the dua is the ibadah and the heart of ibadah. Hence, they're not really doing ibadah anyway. In asking, huh? And that's talking to Allah. Dua is talking to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let not the delay of answering your prayers despite your persistence in asking be the cause for despair. Don't ever give up on Him. إِنَّهُ لَا يَيْأَسُ مِن رَوْحِ اللَّهِ إِلَّا الْقَوْمُ الْكَافِرُونَ. Allah says, those who are hopeless from Allah are those who don't believe in Him. How can you be hopeless or have despair with Him subhanahu wa ta'ala? Means you don't know Him or you don't believe in Him. For He has guaranteed. Where did He guarantee? For Quran. وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبُ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَان. I am close, I am قَرِيب means close. أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ. I will answer the prayers of those إِذَا دَعَان. If he prays or she prays, I will answer them. And he said, if he says the truth. So he has guaranteed answering your prayers. But in the manner that he likes, not in the manner that you like, in the way that he wants, not in the manner that you want, and in the time that he chooses, not in the time that you choose. He guaranteed answering your dua, but according to his plan, not yours. And therefore he moves to number 7. He says, لَا يُشَكِّكَنَّكَ فِي الْوَعْدِ عَدَمْ وُقُوعِ الْمَوْعُودِ وَإِنْ تَعِيَّنَ زَمَنُهُ لِأَلَّا يَكُونَ ذَلِكَ قَدْحًا فِي بَصِيرَتِكَ وَإِخْمَادًا لِنُورِ سَرِيرَتِكَ. Ya salam. He says, do not doubt the promise, because what was promised did not materialize, even if its due time has come. Do not doubt the promise, because what was promised did not materialize, even if its due time has come. Lest this becomes a smear on your insight and an extinguish to the light of your soul. Why? Well, the time he promised, and this is the time. Happens to the people of Al-Ahzab. بلغت القلوب الحناجر. Allah says, وتظنون بالله الظنون. And the hearts became where the voice box is, where the throat is. That's sort of what the Quran is saying. Al-Qulub, the hearts became at the Hanajar. Hunjura is right here. So that's how their hearts are beating. The whole world is against them. Yani in the Ahzab, at that time, in the battle of the Ahzab, literally at that time, the whole world, almost the whole world, because that time that was the world. Everyone is against them. Abu Sufyan went and got everyone in the world possible. That's what was before he announced his Islam. Everyone possible in the whole peninsula against the Muslims. The Sahaba are looking, we have Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we have the promise of Allah and victory. What happens? What's going on? How can we? It's not even possible. You can't even do the math. Forget about math. There's no math. And Allah says, وَتَظُنُونَ بِاللَّهِ الظُّنُونَ. And you're thinking about Allah, huh? Is he delivering or not? هُنَالِكَ بْتُلِيَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ وَزُلْزِلُوا. At that time, that's where the believers were shaken. زُلْزِلُوا. There was zilzal. It's not something. But some of them will always say, كَمْ مِنْ فِئَةٍ قَلِيلَةٍ غَلَبَتْ فِئَةً كَثِيرَةً بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. Some will always say, it's not about the numbers, it's not about the math, it's about بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. الَّذِينَ قَالَ لَهُمُ النَّاسِ إِنَّ النَّاسَ قَدْ جَمَعُوا لَكُمْ فَاخْشَوْهُمْ. People told them, people came to the Muslims then and told them, look, the whole world is against you, what's wrong with you people? You know, you gotta be real. خلي سياسك سياسة واقعية شوي. Be realistic, right? فخشوهم, fear them. Allah says, فزادهم إيمانا. These people, iman is increased. وقالوا حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل. Allah is enough. We're not here because of ourselves, that we can do things or shake things or change things. It is because of Allah's command and His Messenger's command for us, and hence Allah is enough for us. Whatever happens, happens. فَانْقَلَبُوا بِنِعْمَةٍ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَفَضْلٍ. Hence, Allah changed things from loss to win, from wrong to right, etc., etc. So don't doubt the promise just because what was promised did not materialize. Even if its due time has come. Musa alayhi salam takes the people from in the Exodus from Egypt all the way to the sea. These guys are looking, Banu Israel, the Jews at the time, they're looking for, they're believers. They're looking, where are we going? قَالُوا إِنَّا مُغْرَقُونَ. They said, we are, that's it, we're going to drown. The Quran al-Karim speaks on their behalf. We are drowning for sure. Musa alayhi salam, in the, there's nothing. قَالَ كَلَّا إِنَّ مَعِي رَبِّي. Indeed not, Allah is with me. Something will happen, I don't know. But something will happen. So these things are important to things that have, because people then, why is Ibn Athala saying these things? Don't have your reliance on things that you see in front of you. Everything you see in front of you is a delusion. Have your reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that does not perish. His promise is the true promise. Every other thing that's out there in the universe may come through or not. Don't depend on it. He goes then in number 8. إِذَا فَتَحَ لَكَ وِجْهَةً مِنَ التَّعَرُّفِ فَلَا تُبَالِ مَعَهَا إِنْ قَلَّ عَمَلُكَ فَإِنَّهُ مَا فَتَحَهَا لَكَ إِلَّا وَهُوَ يُرِيدُ أَنْ يَتَعَرَّفَ إِلَيْكَ أَلَمْ تَعْلَمْ أَنَّ التَّعَرُّفَ هُوَ مُورِدُهُ عَلَيْكَ وَالْأَعْمَالُ أَنْتَ مُهْدِيهَا إِلَيْهِ وَأَيْنَمَا تُهْدِيهِ إِلَيْهِ مِمَّا هُوَ مُورِدُهُ عَلَيْكَ. He says, if he opens for you a path to knowing him, path of knowledge, path of ihsan, path of dhikr, path of tazkiya, path of mahabba, if he opens for you a path to knowing him, so now that you know about him, you know him. Do not be bothered if your deeds decrease. For he opened it wanting you to know him. The reason he opened this path for you is because he wants you to know him. He wants to give you an opportunity to know him. Did you not realize that allowing you to know him is his gift unto you?
while your deeds are only what you present to him? And how does what you present to him compare with what he grants you? Does that make sense? What you present him versus what he presents you, how can you compare? If he opened a way for you to be in a place that he likes, or in a ilm that he likes, or with people that he likes, or in a place where you get to know him, or with people that remind you of him, or with the ilm that teaches you about him, it is him opening a way for you in the first place to get to know him. Otherwise there would be no way for you to get to know him if he doesn't open for you. Then don't compare your deeds that come from you to him with that that comes from him unto you anyway. Now he's not telling you don't perfect your deeds. We've talked about that, right? Perfection is among the obedience here. We're beyond that. Then he says, تَنَوَّعَتْ أَجْنَاسُ الْأَعْمَالِ لِتَنَوُّعِ وَارِدَاتِ الْأَحْوَالِ. He says, deeds, in number 9, deeds vary in type because of the variability of hal, spiritual state, that these deeds bring unto you. What does that mean? Salah is a deed. Let's say adhkar after the salah is a deed. Learning the ilm is also dhikr. All these things are dhikr, by the way. Huh? This is salah is dhikr. Al-Quran is dhikr. The adhkar that we recite in our tongue and in our hearts before our tongue after the salah is also dhikr. Sitting in a majlis of ilm is dhikr, etc., etc., etc. But deeds vary in type because of the variability of the hal that comes with them. Depending on the magnitude of every deed, and because the deed itself is different, it has a different fragrance of spirituality that comes along with it, of illuminations that it brings onto you. Every good deed brings something onto you with it when you invoke it. When you read the Quran, that recitation of the Quran, if it's done right, it will bring you certain illuminations, and it has certain taste as well, and certain fragrance, spiritually speaking. That's why Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, ذَاقَ حَلَاوَةَ الْإِيمَانِ أو طَعْمَ الْإِيمَانِ. Tasting. So he says the reason now, once you start actually feeling the sweetness of a good deed, whether it's the salah, whether the dhikr is salah, whether the dhikr is siyam, whether the dhikr is qira'at al-Qur'an al-Kareem, whether the dhikr is making salah and salam on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whether the dhikr is ilm, yuntafa'u bih, whatever that dhikr that you're doing, everything, it's like a garden. Everyone's got a different color and a different fragrance and a different spiritual impact that it brings you. And all these things, when you collect them, that diversifies your spiritual capacity to start with. Because the a'mal bring ahwal. Hal, a state, a spiritual state. Those of you who, let's say, are good in their salah, they have hal in the salah. Those who are good in their qira'at al-Qur'an, there's hal in their qira'ah. There's actually vivid illumination and vivid elevation. Vivid. Those who make salah and salam on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, same, there's vivid, you're rising as you're going. And you see that which comes from this kind of deed is different from that comes from different kind of deed. And everything opens up different things because the a'mal take you to ahwal. And ahwal bring with them, or hal, yani ahwal is plural of hal. That spiritual hal brings you from ahwal to anwar, to illuminations. But if the amal is not correct, there's not going to be hal. And if there is no hal, there's no nur. There's no illumination. You can pray 15 million years, makes no difference. If you're praying, you might not be asked about it on the Day of Judgment, but it's not taking you up the ladder, spiritually speaking. You're just doing it technically, and you're moving on. Nothing is changing. It's not changing you to be a better person. It's not changing you to be a better human being. It's not changing you to be a better dhakir of Allah. It's not changing you to be arif. It's not changing you to be any, you know, etc., etc. It's not changing because there's something defective. Allah says, "Inna salata tanha anil fahsha'i wal munkar." As salah prohibits you from doing fahsha and munkar. In this, in what you say, vile words and vile actions. But if you still keep doing vile words and actions despite your salah, where is the problem? In the salah or in you? Your salah is not right. Then he says, and that's why he says after that, الأعمال صور قائمة وأرواحها وجود سر الإخلاص فيها. He says, deeds are upright bodies or masses. It's just like a body. And the soul of the body, of these bodies, are sincerity that's inherent in them. Whatever deed that you do, let's say the salah, is like a body, a mass. The ruh of this body and mass is your sincerity in the salah. If you're insincere in the salah, you have a body with no ruh, with no soul. Your siyam, if you're not sincere in your siyam, you have a siyam as a body, but there's no heart of that siyam. What is then the ikhlas? That you're selfless in doing it. It is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That you're not doing it for any other reason. That you're cognizant of that. That you remember that. That you're not severed from that understanding that you are with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the more ikhlas you have, the better it is. And that's why again he moves number 11, where he says, "Idfan wujudaka fi ardi al-khumul, fama nabata mimma lam yudfan la yatimmu nitajuh." Bury your existence in the land of obscurity. For what grows out of what was not buried does not bloom. Especially important for the students of knowledge. Because we tend as human beings to want to be distinguished. We want to be distinguished. We seek to be distinguished. This is a human instinct. No problem. Be distinguished in doing good. Don't be distinguished in trying to appear. They say, al-zuhur, appearance, yaqsimu aw yaksiru al-zuhur, breaks the zuhur. The zuhur is the backs. Bury yourself in the bury your existence in the land of obscurity. What do you mean you have time to discuss high things? Go study your things. Go study your own books. Go study your own things. Even if you're not student of knowledge, go study things, go read things. You want to talk about things that you have no knowledge of, just so you can be distinguished? He says, bury yourself in the land of obscurity. Something you don't know? Allah says, لا تقف ما ليس لك به علم. Do not pursue that which you have no knowledge of.
إن السمع والبصر والفؤاد كل أولئك كان عنه مسؤولا. Trust me, even if you want to be distinguished when you don't know, that's distinguishment. I don't know. It's okay. Instead of wasting your time trying to prove to people that you are knowledgeable now and that you have such a high caliber understanding, magnificent view of the deep depth of the knowledge of Islam, studying 5-10 years. You're never going to grow. Never. Unless you change. If you don't bury the seed deep under the soil, irrigate it with water, and give it nutrients and nourishment, it's never going to grow up. That's the understanding here by Ibn Ata'illah radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Well, that's obviously something that the Quran gives us in many times. Bury your existence in the land of obscurity. For what grows out of what was not buried. And that's why what's attributed to Ali radiallahu anhu, though the attribution is not authentic necessarily, but allegedly he says that if you don't taste the humility of seeking knowledge few hours of your life, you'll taste the humility of being ignorant the rest of your life. Your choice. Knowledge makes people humble, does not make people arrogant. Makes people more tolerant, does not make people intolerant. Makes people more merciful and accepting of differences rather than less accepting of differences. He says, to this effect, يعني سيدي أبو مدين وابن عربي رحمه الله, both in his تخميس, he says something about them, about this issue as well. I remember also ابن عطاء الله تعالى رضي الله تعالى عنه mentioned something like that. It's not in my mind anymore. Like in the last lines, he says, which means, well, the first line, when he says, مَا لَذَّةُ الْعَيْشِ إِلَّا صُحْبَةُ الْفُقَرَى هُمُ السَّلَاطِينُ وَالسَّادَاتُ وَالْأُمَرَى فَاصْحَبْهُمُ وَتَأَدَّبْ فِي مَجَالِسِهِمْ وَخَلِّ حَظَّكَ مَهْمَا قَدَّمُوكَ Wara, he says. So, ashabu means accompany them. Wata'adab, have adab in their majlis. Right? And then he says, wakhalli hadhak, and keep yourself. No matter how much they push you forward, khalli hadhaka mahma qaddamuka wara. Keep yourself behind, no matter how much they try to advance you. And then he says, if they insist, kun bil jahli mu'tadira. Some other time we maybe will talk about that. Lakin it's a long thing that Ibn Arabi mentions. Khair. Number 12, he says, ما نفع القلب شيء مثل عزلة يدخل بها ميدان فكرة. He says, nothing benefits the heart more than a solitude through which it enters a field of contemplation. And that's why, yani, Sufiya in general, they like this uzla business. Now, I don't mean uzla that you go to the North Georgia mountains and you take some mountain log there and you never want to see anybody, not even animals. No, that's not what we're talking about. Surely the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to go to the cave before and would spend days and maybe more in it, sure. And hence, you know, uzla once in a time like that, you know, taking few days, you know, 40 days or something like that, without counting, without making a number obligatory or a number, a certain set of number regardless. But, you know, you can always take ishara wa wa'adna Musa 40 layla. We asked Musa to stay in the mountain 40 nights. Yani, I'm not saying again, numbers that are not specific, I'm not specific. But, you know, al-labib min al-isharati yafham. The smart understands the ishara. Oh, the other one, even if you bring a big ibarah, doesn't make a difference. Like in general, you know, again, there's no need to stick to a number. But then, once should take some time off for yourself. That you can take some time, the uzla in Ramadan. What do you mean in Ramadan uzla? When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, didn't he used to wake up the night and used to do i'tikaf in Ramadan? What do you think i'tikaf is like today, socialization? Yani, you know, you're sitting in i'tikaf. Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, WhatsApp, Viber, what's the other ones? All the other ones. Habibi, go home. Just go home, enjoy. The point of i'tikaf is that you have solitude with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It doesn't matter of the people around you. You're busy with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're not giving your time to... I have nothing against Twitter. Go ahead and give your time to Twitter if you like. But the point of i'tikaf is not that you give your time to X, Y, and Z. Like, can you give your time to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And nothing benefits the heart more than a solitude through which it enters a field of contemplation. That's what we call meditation. So you mention the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your contemplation, you make dua to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. The reason is when you are with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are more like your true self. When you're with the creation, the human being is an actor. Whichever the situation necessitates, acts accordingly. People, situation, etc., etc. It's an identity that the human being takes as a sort of reaction to the situation. When you're with people who are serious, all of a sudden you talk seriously. When with your people who always joke, you're starting the jokes now. People take these roles. They play these active roles. You are your true self when you're truly with Allah in solitude. Because you know, you are with Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. He knows everything about you. You don't need to make up anything. You don't need to play any role. So you're making dua. You are imploring Him. You are begging Him. You are talking to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're thinking about an ayah. You're thinking about a hadith. And these things open for you many things. He says nothing benefits the heart more than a solitude through which it enters a field of contemplation or meditation in that sense. But surely that will benefit the heart. Yet how can a heart benefit? He goes in number 13. كَيْفَ يُشْرِقُ قَلْبٌ صُوَرُ الْأَكْوَانِ مُنْطَبِعَةٌ فِي مِرَآتِهِ. He says, how can a heart shine while the images of the worlds are imprinted in its mirror? أَمْ كَيْفَ يَرْحَلُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَهُوَ مُكَبَّلٌ بِشَهَوَاتِهِ. Or how does it depart or journey to Allah while it's still chained down by its lusts? أَمْ كَيْفَ يَطْمَعُ أَنْ يَدْخُلَ حَضْرَةَ اللَّهِ. Or how does this heart long to enter the presence of Allah while it's still stained by the impurities of its oblivion? أم كيف يرجو أن يفهم دقائق الأسرار وهو لم يتب من هفواته or
how does this heart aspire to comprehend the intricacies of the secrets and meanings of things while it has not repented its lapses?
In order for the heart to shine, it has to be cleaned. Anything, if you want a window to shine, you gotta clean it up. You can't have it dirty and shines, it's not gonna happen. If it's got all the dirt of the dunya imprinted in the heart, and your heart is like a mirror for transparency purposes, if it's got all these things imprinted, the love of this and the love of that and the love of this and the love of that, etc., 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 how do you want your heart to shine? Or how do you think it can journey, that heart can journey actually to Allah, can move towards its Lord, and it's chained down by its lusts? They're not letting you go. What do you mean you're going? You're going, it means you're leaving us behind. That's not good. They don't want you. The desires don't want you to leave them behind. They want you to stay with them. You gotta make a choice. Either you stay with them or go. But you cannot go while you're chained. There's no moving like this. Or how does it long to enter the presence of Allah while it still has the janaba of its ghafla, or stained by the impurities of its oblivion? Because you want to do dhikr, you want to do salah, you want to do siyam, you want to do qira'at al-Qur'an and all these things, and you want to be in the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fulfilling the maqam of ihsan. But do you think the presence of Allah Ta'ala is impure, that you can just enter with your impurity? I'm not talking about impurity of the body here. I'm talking about impurity of the mind, impurity of the heart. Just like there's janaba that requires ghusl for the body if it happens, there's janaba of the mind that requires different intellectual ghusl of the mind, and there's janaba of the heart that may require intellectual or spiritual ghusl of the heart. But you won't be able to enter the presence of Allah in your adhkar while on a state of janaba, whether spiritual or physical. Because the hadra of Allah is qudsiyya subhanahu wa ta'ala. His hadra subhanahu wa ta'ala is for the pure. You purify yourself, you go in. But you can't go with all the dirt. That doesn't work that way. And then he says, or how does it aspire to comprehend the intricacies of things? Because we're still limited by what we know, and we think what we know is everything. And, you know, alhamdulillah, though despite that knowledge every day comes and tells you different things, then we say, okay, this is the limit. But I mean, a sign of development, since it's increasing, it means what? It's imperfect. Since there's more knowledge that's coming every single day, it's telling you it's incomplete. It was incomplete before when you thought it was complete, and it is complete now when you think it's complete. So you want to understand the things about things, yet you haven't repented from your lapses. It's him subhanahu wa ta'ala who grants the understanding. Wallahi, billahi, tallahi, billahi. No one gives you understandings but him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Especially in matters of the deen. Shuf what an-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fi hadith Bukhari, fi hadith Muslim. Bukhari is Muslim, afwan. Al-Bukhari, ma yurid Allahu bihi khayran, يُفَقِّهُهُ فِي الدِّينِ. Right? Hadith Muawiyah is known. مَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ بِهِ. Who wants khayran to him? Allah. يُفَقِّهُهُ. He will teach him. Allah will teach him. If Allah wills for you good, if you want to know, especially if you're trying to study the deen or know your deen, it's not how many books you can memorize. You need to memorize lots of books. Don't take me wrong. But the understanding Allah Ta'ala opens for you, and the tawfiq Allah Ta'ala grants you.
He says, number 14, الْكَوْنُ كُلُّهُ ظُلْمَ. The whole universe is a darkness. وَإِنَّمَا أَنَارَهُ ظُهُورُ الْحَقِّ فِيهِ. Only illuminated because of the appearance of the truth in it.
فمن رأى الكون ولم يشهده فيه أو عنده أو قبله أو بعده فقد أعوز وجود الأنوار وحجبت عنه شموس المعارف بسحب الآثار.
He says, so whosoever saw the universe but did not perceive him or did not see him subhanahu wa ta'ala in it in a way through the athar of his qudra, not in it in a physical way, at it, before it, or after it, lacks the perception of lights. For and for him, suns of knowledge were blocked by the clouds of impressions and signs. The suns of knowledge were blocked. This addition is actually added. Yani on the original manuscript, الكون كله ظلمة وإنما أناره ظهور الحق فيه أو وجود الحق فيه.
So the addition, whoever sees, so whoever saw the universe, that's an addition. It exists in some things, in some manuscripts, but not in all, to the best of my knowledge.
So he says the whole universe, he's saying the whole creation is darkness. And what illuminated the universe is the appearance of haqq in it.
What does that mean?
How much of nisba, attribution you have to Allah in you. Yani how much haqq and rabbaniyya you have in you, that's how much light there is. But otherwise, the whole universe, he says, is that there's no nur in it. The nur in it is only the haqq. Wherever there's haqq, that's nur. Otherwise, it's all dark.
Some of our shiyukh used to reverse it.
Shaykhuna radiallahu anhu said, and others used to say, al-kawnu kulluhu nur, wa innama azlamahu wujudu al-batili fih. The whole universe is actually illumination. But what makes part of it dark is the existence of batil in it.
Right? So.
Allah. He says, Mimma, number 15, ما يدلك على وجود قهره أن حجبك عنه بما ليس بموجود معه.
ما إله إلا الله.
Of the evidence of the presence of his overwhelming power of his subhanahu wa ta'ala is that he veiled you from him by what is not present alongside him. Yani he is a zahir subhanahu wa ta'ala. Zahir. Huwa al-zahir wal-batin subhanahu wa ta'ala. لكن شدة ظهوره سبحانه وتعالى because he is so ظاهر veiled from him. But he is ظاهر. ظاهر آثار قدرته في كل شيء. ظاهر قبل كل شيء. He was ظاهر before anything. He was ظاهر before anything is made ظاهر. And he is azhar from anything that's zahir, subhanahu wa ta'ala. More apparent than anything that's apparent. And he is zahir after everything. And he is zahir before everything. But what veils you from him is something that's not alongside him. You're veiled, not him.
Nothing avails him, subhanahu wa ta'ala.
For he says that actually, right there. He says, كيف يتصور أن يحجبه شيء وهو الذي أظهر كل شيء. How is it imaginable that anything can veil him while he has revealed everything, or he has unveiled everything? How can, is it possible, or how is it imaginable that anything can veil him while he is apparent for or with everything in his qudra? How is it imaginable? How is it imaginable that anything can veil him while he has appeared in everything in his khalq, that he created everything? How is it imaginable that anything can veil him while he has appeared for everything? How is it imaginable that anything can veil him while he was the manifest before the existence of everything? How is it imaginable that anything can veil him while he is more apparent than everything? How is it imaginable that anything can veil him while he is the one and nothing else is with him? How is it imaginable that anything can veil him while he is closer to you than everything? How is it imaginable that anything can veil him while if it were not for him, nothing would have been apparent or existent? Oh wonder, how does existence appear in nothingness? Or how does the recent, a novice, compare to who is the eternal? Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Naam. He says, ما ترك من الجهل شيئا من أراد أن يحدث في الوقت غير ما أظهره الله فيه. Full of ignorance, he says, number 17. Full of ignorance is he who wants to bring about in a time other than what Allah has revealed in it. Full of ignorance. Everything has its time. Those who don't understand the wisdoms are those who are ignorant. And that's the difference between wisdom with knowledge and little knowledge with no wisdom. And that's why Allah says, وَمَنْ يُؤْتَ الْحِكْمَةِ فَقَدْ أُوْتِيَ خَيْرًا كَثِيرًا. Whoever Allah gives hikmah, wisdom, has given them lots of good. إحالتك الأعمال على وجود الفراغ من رعونة النفس. He says, you're delaying performance, or you're delaying performing deeds till availability of a spare time, shows self-ineptitude. I will, once I have time, I'm going to start doing this. So, you know, you, how many years have you been saying that now? And you haven't done anything anyway? So who are you trying to fool? Creation or the Creator? لا تطلب منه أن يخرجك من حالة ليستعملك فيما سواها فلو أرادك لاستعملك من غير إخراج. He says, do not ask him to withdraw you from a state to engage you elsewhere. If he wanted you, he would have engaged you without withdrawing you. Now I'm not saying, and he's not saying, you shouldn't ask Allah for the best. Ask Allah for the best. But
Don't be suggestive that that situation which you do not know is better than the current situation that you're in. And that situation is where you can be really effective. But this one, you're ineffective because of the circumstances. Had he wanted you to be in that situation, he would have already put you there simultaneously. But مُقَامَكْ حَيْثُ أَقَامَكْ. That's what they say. Huh? مُقَامَكْ حَيْثُ أَقَامَكْ. Your maqam is where he placed you. Let's see what you're going to do. Ask him for the best. And again, do the best you can to maximize the potential of where he puts you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He puts you there. As-salamu alaykum. He puts you there not because of a lack of wisdom. Faddal, Shaykh. He didn't put you. كيف حالكم؟
طيب ان شاء الله
السلام عليكم تفضل تفضل He puts you there, so he puts you here subhanahu wa ta'ala so you can maximize the potential. Not said that you can be suggestive to him about that which you think again is better for you. Then he says, طلبك منه اتهاء له وطلبك له غيبه غيبه منك عنك عفوا وطلبك لغيره لقلة حيائك منه وطلبك من غيره لوجود بعدك عنه. You're seeking from him is an accusation to him, and you're seeking him shows your distance from him. Surely Ibn Atta is not talking about the dua. We've mentioned at the beginning that a dua bukhul ibadah is in the authentic hadith. Your demand of him subhanahu wa ta'ala. I want this. I want that thing. Accusation to him as you're telling him, I know what's better for me. And you're seeking him. You seek who? Who do you seek? The one that's present or the one that's absent? You seek that which is absent. So he says, and you're seeking him shows your distance from him. So the mere point that you're seeking tells you that you're far. Because if you're with him, you're not seeking, you're already there. Right? Suffering. And then he says, وَطَلَبُكَ لِغَيْرِهِ لِقِلَّةِ حَيَائِكَ مِنْهِ. You're seeking anything else is because of your lack of respect for him. And he says, and you're asking from anyone else is because of your remoteness from him. All right, I think let's make a point here, right? So we can continue in the next, not next week, the week after, inshallah ta'ala. And yeah, I think 20 is good. We don't want to also go too fast, but we want to have a sense of completion, inshallah ta'ala. Questions? Yes, ma'am. Did I cut it?
No, ma'a,
Okay, make a note of it if I did. If there's ijma' on the issue. Though there is no ijma' anyway. There is ijma' tawafuq, right, Mawlana? Naam, yes. The Rabbaniya that's there. Yani, for example, anything that has to do with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered you, that's your share of haqq in you, share of righteousness in you. And that by itself is self-illuminating. Even if it's a word of La ilaha illallah. And similarly in the rest of the creation. That's the meaning of it. Now, yes.
I just want clarification. It says that the one who is seeking him is the one that is far, but isn't Allah always close? Can you explain?
Yes. Yani, what he meant to say, if you're seeking him, you're looking for him, it means you haven't found him yet. Right? For there is Ibn Asakir narrates something that Al-Husayn radiallahu anhu used to say, عَمِيَتْ عَيْنٌ لَمْ تَرَكَ عَلَيْهَا رَقِيبًا. An eye that doesn't see you watching it is blind. And an ear that doesn't realize that you're close to it is deaf. When were you absent so that we look for you? And when did your existence need an evidence so we can look for it?
Along the same point, is there a possibility that someone could think that they have found Allah and they've arrived at this, you know, knowledge of Allah, and so they stop seeking Allah because seeking him is an indication that you're far, and now, well, I found him, so I stopped seeking. But in reality, you're somewhere else.
Yeah. So finding Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, obviously, now we're talking here from the point of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sunnah. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sunnah is to do what? Because the taraqqi in these maqamat, in other words, you found him subhanahu wa ta'ala, but is the ma'rifah of Allah limited? No, is it? So therefore you are elevated always in the ma'rifah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala based on your altitude, aptitude, attitude, magnitude, all these things that you have. So therefore the ma'rifah of the anbiya alayhim as-salatu was-salam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they stayed worship their whole life, is not like the ma'rifah of the rest of the awliya, even if they stayed worshipping their whole life, is not like the ma'rifah of the others, etc. قُلْ كُلٌّ يَعْمَلُ عَلَى شَكِلَتِهِ. Everyone works according to their level. But surely there's no arrival in the sense of cessation of ma'rifah, for that indicates that the ma'rifah of Allah is limited, and that's contrary to the truth. Now, and that's why Allah says, "Wasjud waqtarib." So it's a continuous thing. In Allah wa malaikatahu yusallun. It's a continuous thing. Now, yes, ma'am. You're from the Georgia Tech thing, aren't you?
Yeah.
Oh my. Yani, nowhere in the Quran or Sunnah, or even what Ibn Atta Allah said, that it means you don't do what you need to do for your life, but it means you don't depend on your plan, but you depend on His plan subhanahu wa ta'ala for you. So you're not disappointed when your plan does not go through
For what he reveals of his plan is what you take ishara or sign from and you continue. And you still try to continue to do the absolute best in your capacity that he gave you. Still, your effort and the result are not necessarily hinged on each other. Now, you can do the best you can, and maybe the result is not the same. Maybe better, maybe less. It's his plan that you're with. What you do is the effort. Yes?
So the other thing is, like, with words, I know you said their answer, maybe not the way that you expected. So how do you know that?
Because what Ibn Atta mentioned here is that the dua that you should, obviously you make the dua fulfilling the conditions of dua. So you made it sincerely. You make it believing, having full faith that Allah will answer you. Because he did say, أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانِ. He did say that. So you believe that he will answer if you make dua. And you believe that he will answer because of his generosity, not because of your worthy deeds or unworthy, etc., etc., etc. And you persist in that dua. And you keep making the dua. And you submit to his will. Whatever comes in your life, you try to change for the better if you can, and you still make dua, and have hope that he will bring you the absolute best. In other words, you may be focused on a certain milestone. This is exactly what I want. That's not necessarily what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will answer your prayer and give you the best that is for you. And maybe it's not that milestone, maybe something much, much better, much higher, maybe something in a different thing. So what it is rather than being focused on the creation itself, what Ibn Atta is trying to tell you is remain with the plan of the Creator. Do your best and remain with him.
So also, like, when things happen, what they're actually supposed to happen at that time. Is that correct?
Like there?
Like, what I know, it's, I guess it kind of goes back into worrying or like planning too much. So whenever things happen at that time, that's exactly when it's supposed to happen, right? Is that correct?
No, well, he says that the dua that you know is answered, maybe answered after a long time, maybe answered immediately. Don't give Allah a time frame.
Oh, not for duas necessarily, but just the maybe events in your life when they happen.
So you make the best decision based on what's available to you, and you keep asking him for the best. No, look, always, what's always recommended is you ask specifically. I mean, there is an authentic hadith where you can ask for the laces of your shoes if you lost them. Ask. But always ask him what's best for you. Ya Allah, grant me whatever is best for me in the situation, give it to me. So that's what istikhara is anyway, right? I mean, when you're doing istikhara, you're telling him, with your knowledge, whatever is best for me, please make it happen. And have yaqeen that it will happen regardless of the odds. And move on. So ask him always in the dua, yani among the adab of dua, is to ask him to grant you that which is best for you. Be specific and then sort of, but in your knowledge, give me what is best. This is the best of my knowledge, I think this is good. But in your knowledge, give me whatever is best for me. Yes.
I was wondering if you could...
Thoughts, evil thoughts, aren't they intellectual janaba? So if you let these evil thoughts fester and you let them stay and then multiply, and then the mind becomes a ready place for all these thoughts, evil thoughts to come, and then they grow. It's just like fungus. It grows and grows and grows and grows. And the mind, all then the mind can think about is these evil things. The whole point of wudu to the Sufis is that before you wash your face with water, you're washing your heart, right?
And that's the whole point. If you're just washing the face and the heart is dirty, there's no point, because you pray with your heart before your face.
So how do you purify yourself?
So evil thoughts that are in your control, there's two thoughts, thoughts that are beyond your control, thoughts that are in control. Those that are beyond your control, you ignore, and those you are in control of, you shut down, you don't bring them in. You hire yourself as a security guard in your on your brain gate. And you only allow good thoughts to enter. Now, sometimes things are beyond you, so you ignore them. What that means, you're suffocating them from air. They can't survive. But if you don't ignore them immediately, you're giving them space to grow. That's what you're doing. Yeah. You give them, you have yaqeen that Allah, number one, can reverse and change anything. Nothing is far from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What happens in the world, that's according to the rules of the world that Allah created the world in. That's not beyond Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's power. So you have absolute faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you tell that person that way as well, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can reverse and does anything and does anything subhanahu wa ta'ala. Without any reason, without any prerequisites, without any conditions, without anything. Absolutely, positively, 100%. Number two is ala muradillah as well. That whatever the will of Allah is, then you're with it. But you know that Allah, that you have belief in Allah's power and you have belief in Allah's will, both simultaneously. Whatever Allah's will is, but I will ask Him for the best because I know He can do everything. So give Him both. Give Him hope and give Him also the faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well, and make dua for them.
So you can ask for what's best for them, even knowing maybe death is best for them.
Yeah, but don't determine their fate. You're not, that's not in your hands. No matter what people say. Now, I'm not saying it means you're in denial. You're not in denial of what the laws of the creation are. You're just not denying the laws that the Creator subhanahu wa ta'ala uses, which supersede the laws of the creation. Yeah? Salaam alaykum.
When you do dua istikhara, how do you, whatever you ask for, how do you know that that is the path to follow? You know, the what feeling do you?
You do the best. Istikhara basically is simply trying to do, you make your best study of the case, you come to the best conclusion of it, and then before you execute, you submit it to Allah. Ya Allah, this is what my knowledge is, and this is what I'm going to do based on what I know. If you know that this is good for me, make it happen. If you know it's not good for me, then take it away from me. That's what you're doing, basically. You don't have to see a dream. You don't have to see signs. You don't have to see signal lights. You don't have to see anything. You just keep doing whatever you were going to do before, based on your conclusion. If you see vivid sign, or if you see a dream, or if you see anything, or if things do not work, and they're vivid, take it as a sign. You know, if she did the istikhara right, then that's best for her. That's all I can tell you. Again, the istikhara is not tawakkul. It's not just reliance without actually doing your homework. It's doing your homework fully. And istikhara is in doing something that's also shari'i and right and correct. So if you do it right, inshallah, and you do multiple until you feel your heart has sort of, you feel comfortable with it, but also you're doing it based on what you have done as far as homework done. But I mean, no dreams are required for istikhara to be valid necessarily. There's no evidence in that.
Is it a
Yeah, Sahih al-Bukhari, al-Hadith is straightforward. Do the salah and do the dua. That's basically what it is. And keep doing it. One ought to do istikhara and everything they do anyway. It's part of the submission. Now,
how do we, going back to the point about when he opens a way to get to know him, Allah, do not mind if the quantity of your actions lessen. So is that to say that once you've reached a certain state, your action, I mean, so you've perfected now your actions, and now you've reached some sort of, you know, state with Allah, and so now you don't have to do as much dhikr anymore, or you, it's okay if you don't pray as many nawaf and salat anymore? I'm trying to understand.
What he's saying is, don't mix the two tracks together. You've got to work on every track independently. So, if he opens for you a way to know him, and then all of a sudden you see in the other track that your deeds are not as much in quantity or quality as they used to be, do not try to shut that gate that he opened for you to know him. Continue on this track and better yourself on the other track. There is no arrival in the sense that you don't do work. That's not, we don't have that in Islam. Yeah, the Prophet ﷺ, Sayyidul Wasaleen ﷺ, he was working till the last day of his life ﷺ. That's what it is. That's what he meant, and Allah knows best. Okay, maybe I'll ask, yes. So we can ask Sheikh Abdullah, if he is here from California, ask him to say a couple of words as nasiha for the people here, inshallah. Yes. Don't mix the tracks.
Don't mix the tracks.
Do better on this track and do better on that track. If you see yourself lapsing in one, catch up. But then the priorities of what do I do? I have priorities, let's say. You gotta also do your priorities. I have things to study and I do, you know, extra nafil things, for example, for a couple of hours during the night. So you do your priorities. Because the ilm is also dhikr. All right. So let's ask, yeah, tafadda sini.
How does the hadith affect your surrounding?
The?
How does it affect your surrounding and people around you?
The whole point of amal, if it's selfless, is that you're not really with the surrounding in a sense, because the ikhlas and the amal entails that you are with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? That you worship Him as if you are not seeing anything else, not seeing your surrounding, not seeing those around you, but you're seeing Him. Bas.
But does it affect your surrounding?
It does, but that's not important, and that's not as important as you. No. Yes.
Sorry. So, how do you know when you should be persistent in doing something good, or if Allah is blocking it for you and you should stop?
If it's good and shari'i, you can always keep asking for it and be persistent and never give up. Yes. Yeah, you need to ask, and it's not an audacity, it's your greed in His generosity, and He doesn't treat you based on what you do again. You have to understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not treat us like we treat each other. Like, if you're not nice to me the first time, I let it go, and the second time I let it go, third time I let it go, and then fourth time I say, you know, get out of my face. I wouldn't say that, but you know. Right? I don't want to answer your calls anymore. I don't want to, you know. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala
if you sin the first time, and you sin the second time, and you sin the fourth time, and the millionth time, and the billionth time, and you ask Him sincerely, He will grant you forgiveness. That's what He told you. So you got to treat Him based on His generosity, not based on your worthiness. Based on what He told you, that He will forgive you regardless what you do, if you ask Him sincerely. So you're asking Him, don't shut down that door of asking Him, because asking Him is part of dua, which will make you close to Him. Ask Him sincerely, and don't place your asking on your deeds, because that means you're depending on your deeds. You're not supposed to even see your deeds. You're supposed to perfect your deeds and put them behind your back. And now ask Him because of His generosity and kindness. That'll open the door for you with Him. But if you're asking Him after you did a good salah, let's say, I did this time very good, now I'm going to ask Allah because I did this good salah, so you're saying that this salah now is good and that Allah owes you for this? Doesn't matter how good your salah is. You're supposed to perfect it, not just make it good. And ask Him because of His generosity, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yeah?
Sheikh, that point brings a question for me, is that I've heard of this, of using your ibadah as tawassul in your dua. I've heard of that concept. And would that not contradict?
What do you mean, abusing your ibadah?
No, using.
Using your ibadah?
As a tawassul.
Ay, sahih.
So, like, let's say you would do a certain amount of adhkar and then finish it with a dua. After the adhkar, and use the adhkar as a wasila between you.
Very nice. That's a track on its own. Again, one should not sort of block the other. No one is saying you should be negligent in your deed. You should perfect your deeds, put them behind you, not depend on them. But Allah Ta'ala has given you times and places that He specified with khususiyah for dua. Right? Per the sunnah. Of course you use those times and places. You use the khususiyah of the makan and the khususiyah of the zaman. No doubt. It's the application of the rules He gave you. But you don't block one for the other.
Sheikh, what about the people who are stuck in the cave and they use their amal?
Tamam, tawassul
bil
amal
salih. So, can we take this as you can use your amal too?
What these people did is they were seeking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with their selfless act, that ikhlas that they have with Him. It's a moment of ikhlas. So they're saying, every single one of them said, Ya Allah, if you know in your knowledge that I did that selflessly only for you. So that their tawassul is, this is, I did it only for you. It was me and you, Ya Allah, in this. So هذا حال anyway. Tamam. All right, let's ask Sheikh Abdullah to give us a word of advice, inshallah. Tafadhal, Sidi.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, wa salatu wa salam ala khatm al-anbiya, wa sayyid al-mursaleen, nabiyyina Muhammad, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam taslima kathira. Allahumma aftah ilayna futuh al-arifin, wa wafiqna tawfiq al-salihin. منفعنا اللهم بالقرآن بالذكر حكيم اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا منفعنا بما علمتنا زدنا علما معملا متقبلا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I actually feel a bit embarrassed and also I guess you're saying generally uneasy because I just observed just how hungry all of you are for this wonderful knowledge from this very special, beautiful man who I've come to love for some number of years now. And I actually said to the brothers who I rode here with that I'm quite sure Sheikh Nini was going to try to put me on the spot to get me to say something. And actually, I really didn't want to say anything, especially after coming here and to listen and learning with you this very important knowledge, which I guess we can call it a sublime form of tawheed. You know, it is the true tawheed that you're studying. And one thing is to study exponentially, and we learn what the sifat of Allah are, and his asma and things like that. But to actually grapple with these meanings, these real life type of issues, is you know, extremely important for us. And of course, I'm one who would admit that I would be completely incapable to respond in the way that our Sheikh has been able to answer, to respond to you. But I'm just glad to see that Muslims have matured to such a level that we can have conversations which are go beyond wudu and salat and those type of things. And so I'm blessed. I feel blessed to be here with you, and hopefully I will be showered with part of the mercy that you all are being enveloped with by the presence of the angels in this blessed gathering. I will say that I guess something which perhaps may be a benefit would be to reflect upon the fact that, at least the way that I understand it, is that as Muslims, one thing that makes us special is that we not only believe in physical causation, we believe in metaphysical causation. Right now, we know that many things happening in our country and in our world, some things we have the power to do something to change those things, and many things we don't have any power to do to alter anything you know, that is happening. However, when we look at our plight, sometimes we feel ourselves being punished, and sometimes we even feel that others are being punished for what is happening in the world. And it may be the case, but it also may be Allah's way of ridding this world of His special people before perhaps something that we ultimately don't want to be around when it occurs, and Allah knows best about our times. But when I say that we believe in metaphysical causation, it is to reflect upon the very fact that we find many different injunctions in our tradition, such as Allahu fi auni abdi ma kana abd fi auni akhi, that Allah is at the aid of His servant as long as the servant is at the aid of his brother, which lets us know or teaches us that in one sense, if I want help, if I want Allah's help, then I should be helping my fellow man or my fellow woman. Or the fact that sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will circumscribe or limit, restrict the rizq, the sustenance of a person, because of us committing a particular sin. A person may be denied their provision because of a sin that they commit. وَأَمَّا الْإِنسَانُ إِذَا مَا ابْتَلَاهُ رَبُّهُ فَقَدَرَ عَلَيْهِ رِزْقَهُ فَيَقُولُ رَبِّ أَهَانَنِي كَلَّا. Yeah. When Allah restricts the sustenance of a person, the person says, "What, Allah has humiliated me, has insulted me." And Allah says, "Nay, بَلَّا تُكْرِمُونَ الْيَتِيمِ. Rather, you have not honored the orphan. وَلَا تَحَادُونَ عَلَى طَعَمَ مِسْكِينَ. And do you not encourage one another to feed the poor? Feed those who are in need." So we find this connection that certain things we do or don't do have an impact on the physical realm. So when I talk about metaphysical causation, that is something that we have to think about. And even sometimes when we do things bad, when we are subjected to racism or things like that, how often have we subjected others to racism such that we are on the receiving end now? That there's some things for us to think about. So I just believe that what we're involved in right now is one of the most important of all things, is this tawbah. You know, this is about being on the path of tawbah and coming close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, seeking deeper understanding of our Creator, developing a ma'rifah, a true acquaintance with the Creator, that many people only have a very surface, a superficial acquaintance with the Creator. And hopefully by reflecting upon that and realizing that there are many different things that cannot be changed. We don't have the ability to change, but we do have the ability to petition our Creator and ask Him to test the hearts of people. Because a lot of what we deal with right now in society is directly connected with the winning over people's hearts. And Allah is muqallib al-qulub, right? So how often do we turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, asking Allah to make this person realize that I am not as bad of a person as they think that I am. Make this person realize how errant their own behavior is and make them return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So those are things we need to reflect upon, and it's one of the best things we can do is to be upon the path of Tawbah. Remember that what we do can have an impact on the physical realm, and it can have an impact on our lives. And just because we see suffering is not always a sign of Allah being angry with people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He purifies the ummah from time to time. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sometimes he separates the good from the bad. Sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He does it to simply, as I mentioned, you know, this was called something called al-ummatu marhumah. You know, ummati hadhihi ummatu marhumah. Laysa alayha adhabun fil akhirah, adhabuha fid dunya. That this ummah of mine is an ummah shown mercy. It doesn't have a punishment in this life. It has a punishment in the hereafter. It doesn't have a punishment in the hereafter. It has a punishment in this life. Fitna wa zalazil wa qatl, you know, civil strife, earthquakes, you know, natural disasters, and murder. That sometimes people get killed in large numbers. And of course, we decry it, but we don't know. Perhaps it's they are that shariqa that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as in one hadith that he mentioned or said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned that la taqum masaa hatta ya'khudha Allah sharitatahu min ahli al-ard, that Allah, the hour will not occur until Allah removes His special group from the people of the earth. فَيَبْقَى فِيهَا عَجَاجَةٌ لَا يَعْرِفُونَ مُنْكَرًا بَلَا يَعْرِفُونَ مَعْرُوفًا وَلَا يُنْكِرُونَ لَا يَعْرِفُونَ مَعْرُوفًا وَلَا يُنْكِرُونَ مُنْكَرًا, that and only degenerates will be left on the planet who don't enjoy good or forbid any evil. So we don't know. It's always hard to read all of these phenomena, but I do believe that it's important for us to do our best to ensure that we don't do anything to incur Allah's wrath, that we return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and hopefully we'll be enveloped by His mercy as well. And so may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant mercy to all of those who are suffering. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He illuminate this world and this city. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spread the light of this very blessed madrasa. This is a blessed place, and may we continue to benefit from the teachings of our Shaykh and others, others similar in this world. Inshallah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep among us those people who guide us and they call us to the right way, those awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we ask Allah to make us of His awliya as well. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Barakallahu fiik, Shaykh.